Yes, I can still see that people are joining us. The numbers are creeping up. Got more than 230 people with us tonight, which is great.
Gosh. 230.
But I think, yes, that's right. But I think we'll start now, because we've got a lot to pack in over the next hour and a half. So good evening, everyone. I'm Mark Hallett, Director of Studies at the Paul Mellon Centre. And I'm delighted to welcome you, all of you, to this evening's book launch, Wiltshire, the latest addition to the Buildings of England series, otherwise known to many simply as the Pevsner series, in recognition of its creator and founder author, Sir Nikolaus Pevsner. The Buildings of England series was inaugurated in 1951 and published initially by Penguin Books. Some of you will have those older Penguin editions. The research and titles were supported latterly by the Pevsner Books Trust. But since 2012, the series has been supported by the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art and published with great distinction by Yale University Press. And before I introduce this evening's speakers, I'd like to say a word or two about the Paul Mellon Centre for those of you who may not know us. The Paul Mellon Centre, or the PMC as we call it, is an educational charity that champions new ways of understanding British art history and culture. We publish and teach and carry out research, both at the physical centre in London, where I'm sitting tonight, located at 1516 Bedford Square, just off Tottenham Court Road, and through our online platforms. Our archives, library, and lively events programme are open to researchers, students, and the public. And while much of our activity at the moment takes place online, for obvious reasons, I'm really pleased to say that our beautiful book-filled public study rooms currently are open to researchers 3 days a week. Our grants and fellowships programme meanwhile supports institutions and individuals with research projects, publications, exhibitions and events. Through all areas of our work, we promote activities that enhance and expand knowledge about all aspects and periods of British art and architecture. The centre itself, which is part of Yale University, was founded just over 50 years ago by the art collector and philanthropist Paul Mellon. Do come and visit us in person in future if you can, and please continue participating in our many online events. It's lovely to have you, so many of you, with us. Well, tonight it's my pleasure to introduce Julian Orbach, author of the revised 2021 Pevsner-Wiltshire volume in the Buildings of England series, and Charles O'Brien, joint editor of the Pevsner Architectural Guides, will introduce us to the challenges and the pleasures of producing this newly updated account of Wiltshire's architectural riches. This volume builds upon and adds to two earlier editions of the Pevsner Wiltshire, the first of which was written by Pevsner himself and published in 1963, and the second of which, extensively revised by Bridget Cherry, was published in 1975. Like the other freshly revised volumes in the Pevsner series, this new edition of Wiltshire is thus a palimpsest, carrying within its pages the voices, the thoughts, and the knowledge of three successive scholars, interleaved together in a subtle and apparently seamless whole. Part of the great pleasure of reading such a work is a sense of historical depth and richness generated by what can be seen as an especially generous, evolving kind of intergenerational collaboration, in which writers such as Julian reach back and celebrate and share the scholarship of their predecessors while simultaneously adding new information and insights, all of their very own. It's no wonder perhaps that the Pevsner volumes have been celebrated as, quote, the greatest treasury of English architecture ever compiled. And tonight, furthermore, we will have the added treat of hearing about the stunning photographs taken for this new edition of Wiltshire, which were taken by the renowned architectural photographer, James Davies. James too will be joining us, following the conversation between Julian and Charles. Now, before I hand over to Charles and Julian, one more, or in fact, two more things. Now, look, this is a launch event, and so you maybe expect me to say this, but I'm going to say it anyway. If you're thinking of treating yourself or a friend to a wonderful summertime present, Yale University Press is delighted to offer attendees of this evening's virtual launch a special discount price for the new Pevsner Guide to Wiltshire. You can order your copy, or if you order your copy via the Yale University Press website and enter the code Y2169, I'll say that again, Y2169, you can get the book, which is sells normally for £45, at the discounted price of £35. This offer is valid right through to next Tuesday, the 22nd of June. And if you order from the UK, you'll get free postage and packing too. So that's an offer that I don't think anyone can really refuse. The next thing I want to do before I turn over to Charles and Julian is to quickly run through our housekeeping notes. So this is them. And just to say that you're automatically muted when you join the webinar, and you can only communicate verbally if the host, or if we unmute you, which can happen during the Q&A session, which we'll be having at the end, towards the end of this event. As I said, the talk, the conversation between Charles and Julian and James will be followed by a good chunk of time for questions and answers. We really invite you to think of questions, even as you're listening to their conversation, and put them into the chat, the Q&A box. So as it says here, how to ask questions? Well, you can use the virtual raise hand button if you have a question or comment you'd like to make verbally. But many others like to ask their questions through the Q&A box. And if you just write your question into the Q&A box, I'll then, at the end of the conversations, pass those on or share them and ask them of our participants. Use the chat box if you'd like to make comments or if you'd like to let us know if you're experiencing any technical difficulties. Now, this session will be recorded, but please don't take any photographs of the event. And as with all of our events, any offensive behavior by any audience member will not be tolerated. And attendees can be removed from the webinar, but the Pevsner guides and all those who consume them are incredibly civilized. So I don't expect anything of that kind whatsoever. So right, on that nicer note, I'll pass over to you, Charles, and to James, and we really look forward to hearing your thoughts about the new Wiltshire. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. I'm just gonna share the screen. Thank you for that very warm introduction. And welcome everyone to what's only really the second of our virtual launches. For understandable reasons, we did vaguely hope that that Wiltshire might just be spared and we'd have a traditional live launch, but on the other hand, it's also a tremendous opportunity to be able to talk in a little more detail for those of you who follow us and buy our books and show great enthusiasm for everything we do, to be able to talk a bit more of how everything comes about. So this evening, as Mark said, Julian and I are going to be in conversation as editor and author. So really the way the first thing is looking back to 1963 and the first paperback edition of Wiltshire here in the familiar penguin cover design. Running then to 578 pages, now running to over 900 in a much larger format, which gives you an idea of how much has been expanded on the account of the county's buildings. We recall that it was also the volume that Pevsner dedicated to the county of the cottage, referring to the home that he and his wife Lola had near Broadtown from just after the Second World War. And also where, near to Cliff Pipard, where ultimately both of them were to be buried. So Wiltshire was a county, obviously, that Pevsner knew at first hand as a resident. That's not always the case for revising authors for the series, especially those of us who undertake this work in-house. But clearly being intimately acquainted, being resident, can be an enormous plus. And many of our authors over the years have started from the point that they were living in the county and wished nothing more than to be able to take on the revision of their volume. And that does apply to Julian, though he has been there and away and come back. Because I think I'm right to say you were there from the mid-1970s through to the 80s?
The late 80s, yes.
And during that time, you helped undertake the relisting survey for the county.
Yes.
But then went west to Wales, where he took up responsibilities for contributing to three of the Buildings of Wales volumes and helping to complete that series, and then came back via Somerset and the revision of one of the two volumes originally for that county, and finally back to Wiltshire and living in Bradford-on-Avon. So I suppose the first thing I really wanted to ask Julian is, knowing that Pevsner had been resident, though he didn't come to write the book until he was 20, had been working on the series for the best part of 15 years. Do you sort of detect in his writing the engagement of somebody who knew places at first hand?
It's odd, really. It's always odd with Pevsner, because there are these sudden moments where you feel he's right there. And then quite often he passes through a place and you think, that's not a lot. I'm Biddeston, very pretty village. He says it's got a green and a pond, which is kind of typical. And that sort of line of need not detain us long does happen quite a lot. So in a sense, there's always first is Pevsner, the architectural describer. And it's hard to see him saying, stepping out of line or stepping out of his chosen line, I suppose that's the way. You know, you go to the village where he lived, there's very little because Broadtown only had a Victorian church, and you go to the village where he's buried, which is the parish of Broadtown at Cliff By Park, and there's a serious and enthusiastic description of the church. He loved one of the monuments in there. And actually that monument has, that's one of the moments when he gets momentarily really excited. And it's about this thing where the tools of the trade are displayed at the foot of the monument, it's 18th century monument to a carpenter who made a fortune. And there is a slight sense that he'd looked at that several times. And of course, now he's just outside the church in the churchyard.
So yeah, I suppose one always has a feeling that by the 60s, because he was so busy, that there was a sort of hurry, and that he had to cover the ground, and that the methodology was well established. So some of those sort of personal touches had to take second place in a way. Mm-hmm. But of course, I mean, Wiltshire is a big, and I mean, it's not by any means the biggest county in England, but it is large and it's very packed. So it's perhaps understandable that there isn't time for you know, sort of eulogising. But I mean, how would you, coming to it now, I mean, how do you characterise the county?
Well, it's always, I mean, everybody has always been struck by that kind of rolling landscape, that which is essentially the landscape of the chalk, which, I mean, it is unforgettable, but of course it's also the landscape of Sussex and other chalk counties. But the nice thing about Wiltshire is has always been that it's the county of chalk and cheese, the two contrasts, and the flat vales and the rolling downland are the typical qualities that everybody comes back with. I find it a county of hidden spaces too. I mean, one can get on the top of the downs and think nothing is hidden. The landscape rolls on to the sky. And then you find that there's a dry valley that drops in front of you. If it's Marlborough in the area around that, it's full of the grey weathers, the sleeping stones, the sarsens just lying there, completely magical and often miles away from anywhere. Which is an unexpected characteristic of the county because it's relatively underpopulated for its size.
And of course, it has a distinct effect. I mean, the geology of the county has a distinct effect on the building stones and materials that are used.
Yes, I've always loved building stones, and Wiltshire is very rich. And one has to say from the beginning that there's a wonderful amount of brick and timber framing in the areas where there isn't rich building stone. But of course, in the northwest, you've got what is known as Bath stone, but the eolitic limestone from quarries and mines outside Bath, which basically supplied the Bath stone, going right down to the wonderful sort of creamy green of the Tisbury stone of the south, now widely known as Chilmark. Actually, if we go back one, down in the south, you get this thing which is really very special, which is the contrast of the Tisbury, which is the white or the creamy colour here, and the green sand, which is the chequer here. This is the doorway at Durnford, where probably for the first time in British history, the shuttlecock of badminton is displayed in architecture, waiting probably another 8 centuries for someone to invent the bat to hit it with. And then you get very odd inliers or almost people, things coming in from the edges. So the Wiltshire actually has a tiny bit of the New Forest next. And on the church tower at Downton, there's this strange chocolatey stone, which is known down there as Heathstone. Probably has a better geological name. In fact, it's in the geological introduction, which Isabel Geddes did really, really succinctly and nicely for us. But that strange brown means that you can walk into a church and you'll get the brown contrasted with the Tisbury cream. You can go outside, or even on the one you're looking at, and you'll see the flints contrasted with the brown, and so on. I mean, right across the county, you'll find interesting contrasts of building stones.
And, I mean, it's the case that England still needs things identified. Not everyone has actually managed to identify all stones, I mean, ages ago. They're even working on things now.
Yes, I mean, Malmesbury Abbey is wonderful because I had the assistant, and he died aged 99, but the book is dedicated to him and to others, I'll mention in a moment. But Desmond Donovan, wonderful geologist, studied the Greater Oolite. And the interior of Malmesbury Abbey, which appears to be of that type, is kind of interestingly whitish compared to, say, the more golden colours that we sort of associate with Bath stone. And it was Desmond who identified the Malmesbury quarry as being just outside Sherston. And, you know, he found it, as he always found things, by diligent footwork and pushing aside brambles. But I don't think anybody had actually identified it before him.
And if we've talked about landscape, then there's obviously the thing that probably is most people's abiding impression of Wiltshire. I mean, we touched on it earlier, and here is the cover star of the new volume. In fact, Stonehenge is, oddly enough, one of the cover stars that has come back more than once, because it was the dust jacket of the first hardback edition of the first edition. It got displaced by the stones at the similarly important Avebury Stone Circle. But I mean, I think that's probably partly because of the way people are introduced to Wiltshire as a visit to Stonehenge, that the presence of antiquity is incredibly important in the county.
It's something that grows on you in Wiltshire. I mean, I was lucky that I did the volume a long time ago for Pembrokeshire, which has the same feeling that stone grows out of the landscape. And of course, everybody now knows that there's Preseli bluestone within the circle of Stonehenge. So the two are intimately linked. But it's that thing of finding something of incredible antiquity and incredible mystery in an open landscape. I mean, the way that the downland has just stayed so open, and I mean, luckily we've closed one of the roads next to Stonehenge, and I know that Avebury has a road right the way through it. But nonetheless, you can walk, you can stand in the middle of these things and just feel that you are way, way out of time. Tim Tutton Brown said to me that one of the things that is very rarely said about Stonehenge, and I unfortunately didn't say it in the book because he said it to me too late, is that it's probably the first piece of architecture certainly Britain and Europe, in the sense that unlike Avebury and unlike the Pembrokeshire stones, each one of these stones is shaped to be a fitting part of a single ring, and people who know them well will know that there's also the equivalent of mortise and tenon joints up there. There are all kinds of wonderful things going on there, but it's the shaping of that that makes Stonehenge quite outstanding. Next. James, who you'll meet in a moment, took the photographs, and you can see from this, which is the selection that he presented to us of Silbury Hill, which, I mean, anybody who's driven down the A4 would just, I don't think, one cannot drive past Salisbury without a sort of lump in the throat, a kind of moment of how on earth did this come, and how old is this, what is it? And James's photographs, I think, well, there ought to be an exhibition of them, of the prehistoric ones, for their kind of quality of bringing up the extraordinary mystery of these things. And I mean, that kind of sums up, in a way, the feeling that I get from the antiquity of the Wiltshire landscape, as best as anything.
And the other thing that one feels is that these things that don't change, coming sort of much more into the present time. The other thing that always seems strikingly unchanging about Wiltshire are the small towns. And Pevsner noticed how much it was a county of small towns, and that doesn't seem to be any different now, really.
No, I mean, it is. It's a county with one medium-sized town, Salisbury, which is still only 45,000. One large town, which is very special and quite different from the rest of the county, much, much larger, Swindon. And then otherwise, there are a whole series of small towns, each of which characterised in some way or other by a marketplace or a widened high street, a sense of locus, of place. And some of them very, very pretty indeed. And this is Davies and Marlborough. If you go up to Cricklade, you can find the outlines of an Anglo-Saxon town, a rectangular planned Anglo-Saxon town. When you're in Davies marketplace and in the centre of Trowbridge, you'll find a town that grew around a Norman castle. And in Marlborough, you have this dead straight, wide street, which is on a sort of platform above the River Kennet, dropping down below. It's, I mean, from the bottom, you see this really strange kind of geographical levelling out to make this high street, which actually does slope from left to right, but it's not apparent in this photograph.
No. And I mean, I imagine towns, when one thinks about how the volumes do expand from the original texts, towns presumably account for quite a lot of that expansion. But I mean, what generally, where does all the sort of time and effort go?
Well, I mean, the expansion happens because there's too much stuff, you know, rather like the great Lobachevsky. We have to get our plagiarism in from wherever we can. And for me, the historic buildings lists had come in after Bridget had worked. And then after that came the Victoria County history had been going steadily from after the war, but really picks up speed from the 1970s. So there's volume after volume of the Victoria County history establishing the baselines parish by parish across the place. Then the Royal Commission turned up with an office in Salisbury and did a lot of work in southeast Wiltshire, sadly stopped when the office moved away. But the interesting point, I mean, by having these two pictures of towns up, the interesting point is that when the first buildings lists were issued, Marlborough, for instance, was full of Georgian buildings, so too Davies, so too almost any Wiltshire town, and it's all, we now know, it's all refronting, changing, status, going on and on and on, up into the Victorian period. And so when you start to look backwards and say, well, what is this building? And you walk in and you're finding timber frames and things going way, way back. We're changing, the picture changed intensely. In fact, even the listing, which I was involved in back in the early 80s, an awful lot was missed because we didn't have the time or the instructions to go inside every building we looked at. And what's changed things an awful lot more than I could ever have imagined is now the business of having proper dating through tree ring dating. And the Wiltshire Buildings Record in the County Record Office has kind of been the centre for a long, long programme of tree ring dating that's changed the way we've looked at buildings radically. I mean, to take an early one, we've always thought that the great barn at Bradford-on-Avon, called the Tithe Barn, is somewhere around the middle of the 14th. There's a sort of problem in the sense that the middle of the 14th is the period of the Black Death. And treeing dating was rather irritatingly for this one, came out at 1334 to 1379, which leaves the Black Death in the late 1340s right in the middle of it. So we still don't know entirely. But what was really radically, I mean, it wasn't surprising in the end, but treeing dating tells you things you might sort of have half known, but not really put in the forefront. So that the equivalent great barn, also of the Abbey of Shaftesbury at Tisbury, Pevsner had in the book as being 15th century, because that's what the external stonework looked like. And he wasn't a great man for timber frame. And so he just said it had colour trusses inside. In fact, they are enormous crux, not quite as enormous as these ones at Bradford, but still pretty impressive. But what treeing dating did, which was really special, is it got 1289 to 1314, so earlier than the Bradford barn. And what it means, which may have happened at Bradford, though we still don't know, what it means is that probably there was an enormous timber frame barn for which all the timber walls were taken down and replaced in stone, which is what gives the Tisbury barn its 15th century look.
And of course, I mean, that was a shortcoming in the volumes generally in the first editions, was this considerable lack of knowledge about traditional buildings that has, as you say, been so transformed. So in a way, that's obviously an area where we can do a lot more now, and you as a revising author can put these things into the volume and expand people's knowledge about them. What about the set pieces, the things which many might think are the sort of unassailable accounts by Pevsner, such as the great churches?
Yeah, and Salisbury Cathedral is, you know, it is one of the great set pieces, in the way that Pevsner's cathedral descriptions kind of make a series of an unparalleled series. But I had to say, and in fact discovered with other people, that actually it was jolly difficult to walk around Salisbury Cathedral with Pevsner in hand without basically becoming exhausted, because Pevsner went around it four times, once for the exterior, once for the interior, once for the fittings, that's the stained glass and bits, and then once for the monuments. Well, I sort of reduced it to three by putting the fittings and the monuments together. And then I started to engage with Pevsner's criticisms of Salisbury Cathedral, the main ones being that he found the west front, which is here in this photograph of 1860, very incoherent, in the sense that when you start to try and line up the lines of it, its horizontalities become odd. One can see where they're going across, but the sense of a great piece of designed architecture isn't really there. I kind of agreed with him that there's a funny kind of what people call a sort of horror of vacui, a horror of emptiness. So that, for instance, on the left-hand side of the big central window, the architect has filled in a little half arch going up and left and right, both sides of it, as if something needed to be done to fill that part. And if you look over the facade, that happens elsewhere. And there are places where just confusion comes in. Those two towers, they go up and then they narrow slightly just inward in order to make them square, to make the towers work. They're little things like that. So in a sense, I had to have a discussion with Pevsner, take it on, take it back, and try and present that. And with the interior, I kept that sense, which Pevsner does have, of the kind of wonder of that three-colour contrast, which is always seen as Tisbury stone and Purbeck marble, but it's also the fact that those great drainpipe shafts are black against the unpolished Purbeck of the main columns. So you've got that the paler grey and the dark grey. James's wonderful photograph, for those of you who don't know Salisbury Cathedral, is taken through with the added vantage point of the 21st century font by William Pye, which then gives this extraordinary reflection of the roof, which I like very much. And also the thing that he's caught, which is very quite difficult, is the late 20th century stained glass at the very far end of the building by Gabriel Loire from Chartres, putting in the prison of conscience window, which you kind of have to wait for the right moment for the glow to come through it. Often it's too dark to look at.
And I mean, that's, I mean, the things you've just drawn attention to obviously are the sort of typical things that, that as a reviser, you're adding things that have been installed in these churches since the first or even the second edition. But I mean, perhaps it makes a sort of statement about Salisbury that certainly strikes me as odd, which is to say that it's rich in monuments, but it's not in outstanding monuments. Do you feel that that view can really hold in a new edition?
I don't think so. I think there are some clearly outstanding ones, like some of the medieval ones, like William Long's Fay, with this the absolute beauty of the detail of the knight, stone knight on the wooden tomb chest. And he's 1226 next. And that one, you have to just keep looking at the bishop. That's Giles de Bridport, died in the 1260s. And there's so much detail. It's a glorious monument. And historically it's interesting because it brings into Salisbury Cathedral directly the new style of Westminster Abbey, the tracery, the detail. It just speaks of Westminster and the close connections between the great churches of that day. And to go on one more, I mean, it's a triumph of Jones's actually to be able to get this whole thing lit, because most of the time you try and photograph it. This thing is the tomb of Edward Seymour, the Earl of Hertford, died in 1621. It's 36 feet high, which is as high as the biggest and most grand. It's the whole period of the Elizabethan Jacobean hubris, the idea that nothing could stop you celebrating who you were, who you had been, and where you came from, with a tiny nod to religion. There's not an awful lot of it on this one. It's mostly about family. And of course, like all these monuments, it's crowned by colossal heraldry on top. And clearly it's a monument of the up there of the quality of the ones in Westminster Abbey, and indeed attributed to William Wright, who's a sculptor who works on several of the Westminster Abbey monuments. And then there's Gorges. Thomas Gorges, he is the builder of Longford Castle, which is a strange triangular building to which everybody has tried to put arcane and occult and all sorts of meaning into it. And he has this marriage to the very enigmatic Swedish Countess Helena Ulfstotter Snuckenborg, Marchioness of Northampton. Well, she's the one who is the most interesting, we know least about, but she outlives her husband by 25 years. And so this monument is put up when she dies, a long 25 years after he did. And on top of it, and this is the extraordinary thing about it, is that something is going on to do with polyhedra, as you see sitting on all over them. And each of them have meaning, and each one of them needs to be understood as actually having a meaning within the Platonic system of geometry. And at the very, very top of it, we know that's going on because at the very top of it is a dodecahedron, which is the symbol for ether, which is the material of what the heavens are built of in sort of Platonic cosmology. And we know it's ether because on that great big sort of urn globe thing just supporting it is the inscription ab orno, from the tomb ad etheram, to the ether. So something really interesting is going on there. And also these twisted columns, they're 1635. It's just after Bernini completes the great baldacchino at St. Peter's. It's just before the porch at St. Mary Oxford. Twisted columns have a meaning to do with Solomon's temple, Solomonic columns as they were known. There's all sorts of things going on there, and I haven't even begun to go into the carvings inside the roof. And then, I mean, there are funny ones. The one on the left, which is in Salisbury Cathedral, one on the right is not. Pevsner said, well, that it's got a seated female figure holding a holding a staff and a lyre. On the left, a big urn, and on the left of this, on the ground, a curious square slab with the arms of George II in a style consciously antiquated, i.e. of circa 1700. What's actually going on is the Weeping Lady is Hibernia, Ireland. You can tell that because she's holding a harp. And the curious square slab, which looked to me like a cast iron fireback, rather oddly rendered in marble, is actually tufted, even more curious, it's tufted work rendered in marble. It's the purse for the Great Seal of Ireland, because Lord Wyndham was Lord Chancellor of Ireland. And I think rather like the American president and his nuclear codes, the purse follows the Lord Chancellor around on his journey should he decide to seal a great document of state. And I know about it partly because Catherine Eustace, who's been writing about Rysbach bracket, helped me on it, but also because exactly the same purse turned up in one of Charles's Surrey buildings. This is the monument to Lord King at Ockham, isn't it?
That's right.
And
yes.
And you'll see at Lord King's feet is the same dinky handbag, and that's the one that carried the Great Seal of England, and it's the same sculptor and the sort of same idea. In fact, looking at the two, one can understand that probably the Surrey example is outstanding and the Salisbury example is good. But
both are very worthy.
Both are very good.
Yes, and I mean, the Surrey sort of has the benefit of being in a sort of setting, yes, especially designed for it as well.
Yes. There's a moment in sculpture, yeah, or in monumental sculpture, where a sculpture for some reason catches personality, and they are special, and very often they're associated with things like the new sculpture movement at the end of the 19th century. Well, this is 1841, and it's the monument to the scholar Richard Colt Hoare, and I think it's outstanding by R.C. Lucas, who I don't know really very much about, but Colt Hoare is seen, as it were, working over the volumes of his ancient and modern Wiltshire, dressed in a scholar's dressing gown and slippers with a page loosely dropped to the ground. But because his story is one of excavating, finding out the whole history of the county, the chair that he's sitting on is a strange thing intended to sort of be reminiscent of Anglo-Saxon thrones, antiquity. I think it is an outstanding monument, even if Lucas is not kind of known as one of the great sculptors.
No, I mean, he was a sort of curious figure in that, I mean, he cropped up in the bit of Hampshire, southern Hampshire, that I was working on previously, lived at Chilworth, just on the northern edge of Southampton, and was clearly exceedingly eccentric and was said to ride round Southampton in a Roman chariot. And but it has a small body of work, but despite the small size of his oeuvre, what he did was very good. But he built himself a sort of barmy house that sadly long since demolished. So, I mean, actually, in a way, that's one of the nice things of the series is being able to give a profile to these people.
Yes. Well, I walked into Salisbury Cathedral and I found this, which I love. This is the monument to the Boer War, or to the Wiltshireman who died in the Boer War. And it's one of those pieces of arts and crafts work where the combination of materials and the somehow seriousness without being mawkish and without being triumphalist, it's that there's something about that piece of sculpture, which is obviously it's through death immortal fame. So I guess it's the dead soldier presenting himself to fame, but that's a guess. It has that kind of oddly indistinctive sort of theology of the arts and crafts movement. But it's made by somebody I knew nothing about. It's made by Alexander Fisher, who interestingly wrote the book. He taught at the Slade and he wrote the book on enamelling, and you can see that absolutely beautiful blue enamel that's behind the inscription. And one would like to know more about him. But I think it's an outstanding and unknown piece.
So the The other thing that seems important that the books have done since Pevsner's day is to establish particular themes within a county. One of the themes that Pevsner was obviously interested in was the impact of the Renaissance in Wiltshire. But with a lot more work having been done in that area since his day, is there more to say, and do new themes emerge as you've gone along?
Yes, I mean the central thing of the three brutes who turn up in Wiltshire at the dissolution of the monastery thing and collect their spoil: Sir John Thynne at Longleat, Sir William Herbert at Wilton, and Sir William Sharington at Laycock, who are all men in the orbit of Henry VIII's last years. They're kind of collecting riches. They're doing stuff, sometimes quite brutal, in the case of Herbert on the Welsh marshes, Thynne fighting at the Battle of Pinkie, Sharington doing some very desperately dishonest things with the Bristol Mint. But between them, they bring to Wiltshire, straight from London and the Somerset House, the House of Protector Somerset, a kind of Renaissance ethos. And they bring it as rich men always did. I mean, these are oligarchs, really. They bring the stuff by bringing the London craftsmen down, and then the craftsmen also from the continent. And the interesting thing that emerged very, very strongly was this character, John Chapman, who comes down from London just around 1550. And it's clear from letters that he worked at all three. This is there are two extraordinary tables that he did at Laycock in William Sharington's tower. So this is his studiolo on the first floor of the tower. And I'd noticed that one of Chapman's signatures were the funny little brackets that are going around the cornice there, which appear on his windows and all over the place. And when we got to Holbein's porch, which was the porch that was once inside the courtyard at Wilton House, but was removed and re-erected as a garden ornament, the same brackets pulled up the roof inside this porch. And his own work at Longleat has disappeared because there was a great fire in 1567, and Longleat is rebuilt after it by Robert Smithson, great figure of Elizabethan architecture. And the interesting thing is that you get a wave of connections going on, so that you get French artists coming to work at Longleat, Alan Maynard and John Gaunt, Maynard a sculptor, Gaunt a carpenter. And you get Smithson coming. Smithson designed these window bays that were the feature of Longleat for a very, very few years. They were just like on Smithson's drawing, and they were topped by gables, just as at Corsham Court, the mansion on the right. But what happened was that Sir John Thynne changed his mind and just said, I want the bays to go up a story higher, Longleat to be a flat roof, and the whole thing to be much, much grander. In a way, Thynne and Smithson together make the leap from the gabled house of the Tudor Elizabethan period to a kind of Renaissance palace. And that leap is quite extraordinary, but it's so clear in Wiltshire because of the drawings and the connections between Longleat and Corsham. So if you look from the photograph of Longleat on the left to the photograph of the hall in Bradford-on-Avon on the right, you'll see the old triple gabled Wiltshire house is there, filled with ornament that sort of starts at Longleat. And if you look at the roundels under the windows, they're just the same, one to the other. And the cresting above those bays, which you can't see so well on the hall, is just the same as the cresting attributed to the Frenchman Alain Maynard at Longleat. And that kind of connection goes on and on and on, because clearly the hall is the work of William Arnold, who designed Montacute. And those of you who know Montacute in Somerset will recognize those half pipe curves are on the end walls, on the windows at the end of the Great Hall. And the fireplace inside the hall here in Bradford-on-Avon is replicated in Montacute and in Stockton House in Wiltshire. And so Arnold then becomes a character who goes on and ends up building Wadham College in Oxford. It's a sort of sequence going on.
Mm.
And one of the last things I just mentioned in this kind of way that things are connected is I walked into Littlecut House right out by Hungerford on the extreme eastern end of Wiltshire. And suddenly I was looking at plasterwork, which was the plasterwork of Somerset. It was the plasterwork of Montacute and of Nettlecombe Court. And I realised that what had happened was that the character from Somerset called Robert Eaton of Stegersey had actually been taken to the far side of Wiltshire because the patron at Littlecote was the lawyer Sir John Popham, the chap who tried the gunpowder plot people, and used there. And of course, there weren't that many people who could do things. You know, one, at this point, when one's looking at houses of this extreme sophistication, the pool of people that you could use was relatively small. So one shouldn't be surprised at finding these resonances through.
And I mean, it's sort of remarkable that William Arnold, who you connect with all these works, not even a name that even features in the first or second edition.
Yes.
It is someone who has emerged.
Has emerged, and he's all over the Dorset volume. And yes, it's a completely new name. I mean, not to architectural historians, but he's come up recently as a name.
And of course, the other great sort of thing that Wiltshire really is a key locus is Anglo-Palladianism. And where does that begin? It begins here, really, doesn't it?
It begins at Wilton. I mean, the interesting thing about Anglo-Palladianism or the adoption of Palladianism as 18th century style is that what Wiltshire proves probably, is that what's actually going on is that the Palladio comes into England with Inigo Jones in the 1620s. Inigo Jones builds Wilton House here in the 1630s. And it's from this particular house that so much follows. And so that, in a sense, Anglo-Palladianism could just as well be described as revived Inigo Jones. The connection goes that Wilton burns down, Jones's assistant, John Webb, rebuilds it. John Webb then goes on after the protectorate in 1660 to build Amesbury Abbey, and Amesbury Abbey has changed, but that's what it looked like. A chap called William Benson, who's the Surveyor General of a very bad reputation, who took Wren's job after him in London, rents Amesbury Abbey in 1708 and designs for himself a house just, well, not that nearby, but also in Wiltshire, called Wilbury House in 1710. His, the theory about Benson is that he had a deputy surveyor called Colin Campbell, who was probably more than capable of designing everything that Benson ever said that he designed. We don't know, but Warwick Rodwell suggested to me that if Colin Campbell could well have had a hand in Wilbury House, I don't know. But what's definite is that when you get to Stourhead, this is Colin Campbell in 1719, just a few years later, a very serious classical house, and it's designed for Benson's brother-in-law, Henry Hoare, and allegedly, at least according to Benson, well, it is almost generally with Benson leaning over the shoulder and giving unsolicited advice, so that the connection goes through to Colin Campbell and the beginning of the Palladians. And then when Lord Burlington takes over the leadership of the Palladians, he turns up in Wiltshire with his first major house at Tottenham House, now completely enveloped in an enormous mansion of the 1820s, which produces that towered profile which we've already seen at Wilton. So the references back to Jones are there, and it's not so much Palladio, it's as much Jones. Then you get John Wood in Bath. He's making Queen Square in the late 1720s. A Bradford-on-Avon clothier says, I'd like to enlarge my house. And so the left-hand side of this is a pure classical seen through the lens of Palladio by John Wood, 1734. And then the great thing is that it goes around in a full circle. Exactly 100 years after Inigo Jones and Wilton, Roger Morris, who's worked at Wilton with the Earl of Pembroke building that lovely Palladian bridge there, turns up at Lydiard Park. And the details, he's refacing an older house, but if you look at the details of the towers, the cornerstones, and particularly the sweeping out of the windows at the bottom, it's pure Wilton, and it's been reused, and Morris becomes, and isn't it already by then, an important figure in English Palladianism. Mm.
But of course, meanwhile, sort of slightly older traditions were still very much in fashion with a certain class of Wiltshire client.
Yes, well, I mean, the thing is that the Baroque, which, if you like, is the style of Hawksmoor and Vanbrugh, is there, and certain people liked it. One of the great generals of the War of the Spanish Succession, or the French Wars, who had fought at Blenheim and was wounded at Marplaquet, General John Richmond Webb, had this house built in 1711-12. He may have designed it himself. He certainly put the bell of Lille in that turret there. He had captured Lille in 1708 and was inordinately pleased with the bell that he brought back. So that's why it's there. But it has nothing to do with those experiments in classicism, that whether interpreted through Jones or Palladio. It's a kind of thing to do with curves and those kind of Baroque forms. And this one, which is all, could well be a house of someone in the Hawksmoor circle, possibly John James, 1716, that the way that curves go into the pediment, especially on the right-hand one, Clarendon Park, built for a London merchant, 1716. And then this wildly Baroque one, 1728, built for an MP. And then you get the clothiers of the very, very wealthy clothiers. This is Trowbridge in 1730, where that kind of syncopation of the way that the decoration between windows sort of changes from one bay to another. So it's an interesting rhythm. It's taken from the front of Durham Park, which is a house of 1700, and reused in 1730 by someone who wanted to make a statement on the main street of Trowbridge, and a statement that no one would forget. And that's again, the same time that Palladianism, in the sense of John Wood's house at Bradford-on-Avon, is creeping in, but Thomas Cooper here wanted none of it.
Yeah. And I mean, that actually links to those sort of people who were actively building in the towns to something which probably people don't really think about in Wiltshire in their general picture, is actually the importance of industry to making the county wealthy.
Yes, I mean, Pevsner's Wiltshire is very good on industry, and that's for one reason, really, which is that Ken Rogers, who was the county archives at the time, guided him through it, and Ken wrote the book about the Wiltshire woolen towns, and Ken has the distinction of being thanked as acknowledged in 1963, 1975, and also in 2021. He took me around Trowbridge in his in his old age, but very, very dedicatedly. And so that, in a sense, I didn't really do a lot to the woolen town story of Wiltshire. That was already there. I felt I needed to celebrate more the great triumphs of transport, that in the sense that the Kenneth and Avon Canal has these two aqueducts at Avoncliffe and this one here at Limpley Stoke, that are just, well, they are the great monuments of the canal system of the 1790s, and John Rennie's the construction. But the way that they take the canal over the River Avon is just so superbly strong. I mean, Pont Cysette, obviously in Wales would be just as good, but of a different type. And Pevsner oddly said that this is Box Tunnel, of course, and it is, you know, it was the greatest tunnel ever made. It was the longest tunnel ever made. It was a superb feat of engineering. Pevsner rather played it down and said that it was a considerable achievement of Brunel or something like that. But the Great Western Railway transforms Wiltshire in all sorts of ways, although it only passes through the North End. And everybody, I mean, Swindon is the railway town, and the railway village at Swindon is something that makes the Great Western Railway really quite special. But its very early concern for the housing of its workers, this is 1843-54, Brunel designing it, and it's absolutely complete. And the great thing about Swindon also is that its origins are greatly respected. And this is a very early piece of townscape preservation, probably in the 60s or 70s. Mm. These things were restored when all over the country, these industrial villages were being demolished. And the Great Western Railway had this extraordinarily wide-ranging medical fund. They had, by the 1920s, what is supposedly the largest workforce in Europe. There are 14,000 employed in Swindon. And for it, the medical fund produced a building in the 1890s that had everything from swimming pools to baths, to doctor's rooms, chiropodists, dentists, Turkish bath, all of the rest of it put together. And as you can see from this is the large swimming bath. It's still in use, but it's a kind of tribute both to the Great Western Railway and to that idea of all-round provision that some of the great enterprises could do. And Irene Bevan said that this is one of the inspirations for the National Health Service in 1947.
So mentioning Swindon, of course, raises the issue of that's common to the volumes, which is that a lot can happen between the first and the third edition transforming a particular place's importance in the architectural story.
Yes, I mean, very quickly. I mean, Swindon is a wonderfully fascinating place because everything happens so fast. Things that were admired by Pevsner, like the Powell and Moyer Great Hospital, gone completely. Things that were put in by Bridget Cherry, like Norman Foster and Richard Rogers and their wives that did the Team 4 of Team 4, as they were called then, did the Reliant Controls building in 1966, gone completely. And there's also the kind of extraordinary thing that it's a new town built on an old town. The railway goes, there's the collapse. Swindon sort of reinvents itself as a new town, but municipally organised. And this great tower in the middle, the David Murray John Tower, the 1960s, sits over a shopping precinct entirely developed by the corporation. I think that's one of the best tower blocks of its period. But also, I mean, interesting in the sense that the very lowest floors were offices. The rest of it was council housing. And I mean, Swindon was superb in that way. It was naughty. It was quite interesting. It's the one place where they named the council offices after Wat Tyler, the leader of the Peasants' Revolt in 1381, just at the time when Margaret Thatcher was trying to re-establish the poll tax to be in the cause of the initial Peasants' Revolt. It's a fascinating place. And of course, it all sorts of things go through there, so that there are factories. And then there's the development of what we might call the business park, little offices scattered around in a green landscape. And then coming from America, even as early as the 70s, you get the office campus, which was that previous one, which is the huge nationwide thing. It's sort of like a small university. And then you get the era of the big shed, which is warehousing. And then once in a while, somebody does something that is just so totally not the big shed, although its purpose is the same. This is Norman Foster's Renault building. And it's a distribution center, so it basically is a shed. And it's one of the most remarkable sheds in Britain. And just to finish up with that story of why things fail, well, not fail, they change so fast in Swindon. There's no longer anything to do with Renault in the Foster building. It's got a children's playground and a lot of secondhand tires. And similarly, the great building, the great factory for Motorola, you remember Motorola, the car radio people? It stands on the top of Swindon, and that huge pipe for the services over the top of the building, absolute landmark. One hopes it'll never go, but it's got NHS offices and I mean, Motorola have just gone. And that kind of speed of change is just astonishing. And I mean, basically that's the interest. I mean, my volume for Swindon will be probably being rewritten even now as things that I've praised will be going.
Yeah, it is incredibly quick turnover for buildings of that generation that made it so vulnerable. And I'm going to make an unfair comparison between this photo, Julian, which is yours.
Dreadful.
And the previous one of the Renault Centre, which is James Davies's photo. So that's the point at which we're going to introduce James to the conversation for the sort of last 10 minutes. And to say that James has been a photographer for now several, I can't actually say how many volumes he has shot the colour photos for. We only went into colour in 2002, and over time they got better and better, and that's partly because, it's all to do with the photographers who we've engaged, and James has really, as Julian said, it deserves an exhibition in his own right for the number of wonderful shots that he's taken for us. But of course, it's not an entirely straightforward business. James has the benefit of living in Box in Wiltshire, so he is closer to hand. But we thought it would be a nice way to finish, just actually learn a little bit more about how he makes these buildings look so wonderful for us.
So
I'm going to handle the photos. Julian is going to ask James about them.
Yes, I mean, the first interesting question is how do you decide which particular view is going to work in the book? Those of you who've got the book will realise that this isn't, for instance, the photograph that's been chosen.
Well, it all starts, doesn't it, with the defining view, you know? I don't have that wonderful luxury of being able to build up a series of images to help understand the building. You know, I've got one shot. So where you stand becomes absolutely pivotal in defining what you want to say. Added to which, you've then got to consider the light, you've got to consider trees and their foliage, the absence of cars, the absence of people. You know, these volumes have got longevity and we don't want to date them. And then there's garden furniture I might have to move, signage I've got to think about. I mean, the list is endless. So I'm constantly trying to reduce and reduce. So to keep distractions at an absolute minimum. I mean, the great American photographer, Arnold Newman, had that lovely phrase that photography is 1% inspiration and 99% moving the furniture. So it's also that tricky dilemma in wanting to achieve both the objective, but also the aesthetic, you know, the understanding and the pleasure. And I should add that, you know, I fail all the time. It's not uncommon with the best planning in the world to make a 5, 6, 7 hour trip and not take a single photograph. You know, failure is a huge part of the process. This is Marlborough College. This is the science building, 1933 by W.G. Newton. And it's the straight on view. I'm kind of versed in Walker Evans, so I like the straight on view. But in fact, that is a rare view because I'm standing inside a bank, right down. I'm on a very tall ladder, very tall tripod, and I've got a rare view, but it's not giving us all the information. So Charles, have we got another picture there? Exactly. So here, straight away, we can see it's got radiating wings and we can see the lantern on top, all which were hidden in the previous picture. So it's all about that defining view.
And then, I mean, when you set out to take these photographs, I mean, how much, in order to actually get there on the day at the time you wanted, I mean, how much is that? The pre-planning must be considerable, I mean, complicated.
Yeah, it is. It's maps and weather, you know. I'm constantly thinking about light. Constantly thinking about which way the elevation faces and where I need to be in order to respond to that. So we've already seen this. I must have made 5 or 6 separate trips to get this shot. It's taken at a very specific time of day to get the relief, but also specifically shot in winter to reduce tree foliage. So if I shot that in summer, the tree on the riverbank would completely swamp and conceal information. So I think photographing for these volumes is about two main things. It's about perseverance and it's about problem solving. Charles, have we got another next slide, please? Because it's coming back to that defining view, isn't it? You know, I'm standing in a position that emphasizes and includes that great strapping great Doric cornice. Now, I never know, Julian, what you're going to write. Pevsner never mentioned the cornice. But by emphasizing it in the photograph and you now describing it in the revised edition, I think there's a very lovely unconscious dovetailing of image and text. Now, I've got another photograph coming, which is, this is the Chinese temple of 1746 to 8 in the grounds of Amesbury Abbey. And again, it comes down to repeated visits. The lovely owner told me he was going to be taking down a tree that had come to the end of its life. And that was certainly going to improve the view. So I waited another year, waited till the following spring before the woodland canopy really got going. And I had all that lovely silvery light on the water, that lovely silvery light on the branches, which I needed to counter on the temple itself. Because actually, looking through the camera, a lot of that information failed to register. It just went into deep shadow. So I've had to light the upper portion of flintwork to balance with the flintwork below. And then I've lit the two walkways either side with flash, so they become readable to the viewer. So ultimately, I'm always trying to maximize the information, make the building as legible as possible.
And that lighting, the question of hidden lighting, I mean, the one I certainly would never have guessed that there was so much hidden lighting in that shop, which just looks like a building just loving its own setting, loving its own light, that half of the light is yours, which I think is wonderful. And the lighting of Bishop Bridport, I think, also had that problem, had interesting problems.
Yeah, it does. And, you know, I love to use natural light as much as I can. But to render the detail, it nearly always results in lighting them. So actually, very often, it's a combination of daylight and flash. So we've already met the Bishop of Bridport. The first thing I've done here is to turn off all the cathedral lights. So I'm just working with daylight. I'm not working with tungsten or sodium or any mixture. And then I've lit the front elevation with lights to either side to bring out that wonderful carving. But the real problem here is how you light the effigy itself. So I've got two small lights hidden in the canopy. They're directing light downwards to give the effigy relief and depth. Can we see that, Charles? Have we got the next picture?
There you are.
Exactly. So just to add to that, actually, that in the volume, this image probably goes no larger than 3 by 3 inches. But I always try and photograph to a standard where you could print it to the size of a double-decker bus. You know, I want that level of clarity. You know, with the image being reproduced relatively small, each square inch really has to earn its crust, you know? Yeah.
One of the things people will notice when they get to the photographs is that James always arrives at a modern building after dark, and the quality of light within the building and evening light outside is extraordinary. But how, what makes a good photograph of a modern building? How do you decide when to go?
Gosh, well, with such heavily glazed buildings, I just think it's really important to show that transparency. You know, if I shot that in daylight, you just wouldn't be able to record that. I mean, you'd almost get reflection. This is Winterbrook House. This is Ken Shuttleworth for himself, 1996 to 7. And it's interesting you bring up the timing, Julian. You know, I've actually arrived 2 hours before twilight here to set up lights and be in a position where I want to be shooting west, where twilight's going to be at its most vivid. And is there another picture, Charles? I've had to expose for three elements here. I've had to expose for the 4 meter high concave glazed wall. I've then had to light the two crescents with the help of Ken himself. And then I've had to balance those two exposures with the twilight. And I think there's another example of that coming up. Yeah, good. So this is the pavilion at Orr House, 2000 to 2004, by the Chinese-American architect I.M. Pei, probably best known for the Louvre Pyramid in Paris. Now, I shot this on Midsummer's Eve, and I photographed it with the setting sun. But what I really wanted was the twilight shot to accentuate the lantern effect. So Charles, if we could have the next slide. So outside lights were all turned off, furniture rearranged. Then I waited and waited and waited for that magical 15 minutes. And it is only 15 minutes when the sky reaches that wonderful crepuscular color and I can balance the exposure of the sky against the warm interior. You can just make out the North Star in that picture. Yeah. I think it was taken about 10:45. So I think that's a good end for me. It was Paul Mellon, the Paul Mellon Centre, of course, hosting this evening, who was such a great supporter of I.M. Pei. He commissioned the East Building at the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. So fitting to have that lovely connection for Wiltshire. Yeah. With its very own glass pagoda. Well, and Charles, actually, is there one more picture?
Oh, there is, most important. Yeah, here is Pevsner's grave at Cliff Pipard by Will Carter, the typographer and letterer. It's poignant to note that Lola died the year that Wiltshire was published. Nikolaus still had many years ahead of him. And what I always feel, what a huge debt we all owe to him. So that's where we're going to close. Thank you all very much. Thank you, James, for talking us through the photos. Thank you, Julian, for telling us about your work. Mark Hallett, I'm going to hand back to you, and you've kindly said you'll handle the questions.
Yes, thanks very much indeed. And thanks to all three of you for such interesting conversation and such illuminating reflections and commentary on the buildings and the photographs of the buildings that feature in this amazing volume. We've got a lot of questions to get through. We've only got 1/4 hour until we end. So I'm going to try and be quite, and maybe you could be quite quick on your answers. We've already got 10 questions that are very interesting ones. So one question that that John Peverley has asked is about choosing the buildings to illustrate in the new Wiltshire volume. What are the special buildings or monuments, Julian, that had to be left out of the list of 118 photographs that were selected?
Dozens. I had a list of about 180. And the odd thing, actually slightly humbling, is that I ended up with an awful lot of buildings that had already been chosen by Pevsner in 1963, you know, that were unavoidable. You know, they just had to be in. So yes, it was appalling, the whole decision. Quite appalling.
Another question that's very interesting from Cameron Newham. This is really for you, James. Cameron writes, it's interesting that the photographs are now made timeless. I wonder why this decision was made in the latest volumes. I find the pictures in the very old volumes to be fascinating because of the indicators of the years they were taken.
Oh, that's very interesting.
Yeah.
My life would be so much easier if I could include cars and people. There was a picture Julian showed of Devizes and the Market Square. I had 4 cars removed from that picture. it is. It's the actual edict came down from Pevsner themselves, you know. These have got a long life, these pictures. Cars and people aren't desirable. I actually think that the motor car industry is going to change so much in the next 10, 15 years that actually the inclusion of cars is really interesting.
Yeah, it's a very good point. Here's a note of not a complaint, but of a kind of question, but with a raised eyebrow in the question, I think, from Peter Verity. A wonderful work, but why did Yale decide that, unlike Somerset, Gloucester, or Oxfordshire, Wiltshire did not deserve two volumes? There you go, Charles.
Charles, yeah, blame the editor.
Blame the editor.
Very, very difficult decision. And I won't say that Julian didn't lobby hard for it to be two volumes. But we felt we could just about get away with it, that we could expand to the sort of limit. I think you, Julian, had a feeling that it was a sort of difficult county to divide in a sort of obvious way, whereas some of the other counties had offered a solution. But it's very difficult. I think we'd always like, if it's possible, to keep a big county in one, even if it is quite hefty. But yeah, we did struggle over it for some time.
Good, at least that's right. Our questioner can know that you thought about this quite seriously. Sebastian Warmall has written a question asking, Julian, you didn't mention the Gothic revival. Are there any outstanding examples in Wiltshire? The extraordinary Fonthill Abbey.
There are one or two things that really, it's a funny county actually, because the Victorian stuff is occasionally very surprising. I mean, like Brittleton House, which is totally out of the sort of Gothic, it's a kind of melange of every possible Victorian style put together over 30 years. But then there's also the Pearson Church at Sutton Veney, which is almost, in my mind, as perfect a Victorian church that one could find anywhere in the country. And the Brooks Church at Marston Maisie, which is really small, but there's some kind of perfectness in its proportion that means that, I mean, Marston Maisie is almost the remotest village in Wiltshire, right up by the Thames, and definitely worth the effort to go up there. Mm-hmm. But it's missing on those, you know, those great Gothic houses that are all over Hampshire and into Kent and Sussex. Yes, it's variable on its Victorian things. I mean, I could find you many a minor masterpiece, cottages that just do it. You know, but the set piece things, not so much.
Thanks very much, Julian. Another question for you. There's a question from Christopher Marsden, who asks, Wiltshire's examples of early mass concrete buildings of the 1860s and 70s. Does the volume include any of these, or are they thought to be below the salt?
No, I mean, I have a terrible feeling that I didn't always catch them, but there's the extraordinary story of the Baring family in All Cannings, where they decided to experiment with concrete to find out whether it was cheaper than conventional buildings. And they found out that it was more expensive, but went on and built a big farmhouse and two or three cottages there in the 60s. And then there's Marlborough College when it got with George Edmund Street, that two of their boarding houses are built of concrete. So there's a degree of interest in it, but I have a horrible feeling that more will turn up, mm-hmm. because, well, concrete houses can look like houses that have just been cement renders. So that, and unless the information is there, one can so easily miss them.
Thank you. From a question, from, in fact, our first question of the evening, long ago, 6:34, from Colin South. Colin is asking, this is a question for you, James, actually. It's about, Colin would like to know more about the type and amount of post-processing that you apply to your photographs. Also asked whether you have a website, so you can promote yourself as well, but it'd be interesting to, he's asking about this issue about the post-processing.
Very quickly, no website. Terribly important post-processing. Spend almost as much time in post-processing as I do taking the images. Not unlike working in a darkroom with paper and an enlarger. So I try and keep all those rules of printing analog, but in a digital environment. So, yeah. You can just be more accurate digitally than you could in a darkroom where you used to burn and dodge. But I would spend hours in a darkroom perfecting a print, hours. So similarly here.
Thank you. Thanks very much, James. A question here from Elizabeth Dobson. She asks, I'd like to ask you about coverage of war memorials. Delighted to see the Alexander Fisher tablet. Generally, this kind of informational coverage is scanty. Even conspicuous monuments of little detail on designers and especially makers. And Elizabeth's wondering why this is the case.
I mean, the thing that's happened, of course, is that war memorials, suddenly there's much more information and people are looking. And I think one of the things that happened with me is I realized that I was looking in the wrong places, that very often the deposited plans in county record offices didn't include the war memorials. But if you went into the parish council deliberations, you could find the most wonderful ding-dongs, the glorious one in one of the Wiltshire villages, where they debated, for reasons completely unknown, whether or not they could exclude the son of one of the larger houses of the neighbourhood from the list of names on the war memorial. I won't tell you which one. And of course, inside that came these quite well-known names, particularly of the post-First War period, like Sir Charles Nicholson at Purton, or Ernest Richmond, who's an architect in Palestine, but turns up designing one in Potton. People did turn up, but it took quite a lot of quarrying to find the names. And I suspect that often it's disappointing. What actually happens is you find that they went to an architect, had a lot and lot of discussion, and then discovered that they could get a really quite decently cheap one from Monumental Mason, based on a design that had been published by central government, whatever. So yes, but I did try. There are more war memorials than there were before.
And I think this is a way that actually the sort of resources that are available on the internet have really changed the whole research approach for the series, even in the last 10 years. That ever since things like the British Newspaper Archive puts these huge collections of local papers on, it is far easier to find out this sort of information than ever before. And church faculties and being much better catalogued and indexed for memorials in churches. I mean, I think there's still a gap in the for First World War memorials in churches to individual fallen, often of a simple but very sort of good quality. And I find, as a rule, you can never find who designed those, but they're often very well lettered, and you feel there's a sort of hidden story still to be researched there.
Can I just, we have someone who would like to, who's raised their hand to ask a question in person. So Danny or Shauna, it's William Newson. I wonder if we can get William to ask the question in person.
Hi, William.
Can you hear us, William? I think you're now able to ask a question. You unmute yourself.
We're not getting anything.
Right, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Yeah. Julian, do I assume that behind you is a photograph of Nikolaus Pevsner?
Yes, character placed there, seemingly
strategically,
but actually strategically placed by my editor.
And Julian, I believe you actually worked with him. So my question is, what was he really like, and how did he manage to fit so many books into this series?
Well, the extraordinary thing I think is, and especially when one looks into the biography, is the astonishing speed that he did it. And one has to say that we would all bury ourselves sooner than do a job like that. I took 7 years to revise a book that he appears to have taken two academic summer holidays to do. I mean, it is amazing. But by the time I worked for him, he was charming. He was solicitous. I was the junior, I'd just been employed by the Victorian Society just after university. He was near enough to retirement. I used to go there and talk to him. I was working for the Victorian Society, and he would go over the cases that we were going to discuss that evening and show me curious things like the unexpected collection of beer mats he had in his desk drawer. And my grandfather was German, and to the end of his life, he had a very distinct German accent, as of course Pevsner did. And he was delightful, I mean, careful. The Victorian Society Committee, if anybody remembers some of the characters involved in the 70s, was full of conflict and interesting always, but argumentative. And Pevsner had asked me quietly before we started who was likely to slash up who over a particular issue. And but when the conflicts happened, he was emollient, and quite often he was in the middle of it, because if he said that a Victorian building was horrible, which he often did in the early volumes, and then it came up for demolition, of course the prime thing on the agenda was, what do we do about the bit in the buildings of England that says terrible? And he, you know, he was very concerned about that, and constantly explaining that he now saw that everything you said had a consequences far along the line from where you had been before. Now, he's a lovely man to work for.
Julian, bearing in mind that he worked in such a hurry, and some of his words were very brief, how much of the wording of his remains? Did you write the whole of the 900 pages?
Well, I sort of did. I mean, the way you do these things, if ever you're trying to plagiarize someone else's book and use it, is that you set out with the text in front of you, and then you add the new bits that you want to add, and you take away the bits that have changed. And then the whole thing looks like a mess. And then you start to subtly add clauses and link bits. And it's kind of a painting operation where in the end you've repainted the fourth bridge.
But Julian, it's...
Julian, sorry, William, I have to draw this to a close now. I'm sorry, William, we'll have to close that. There's so many other great questions that have come in. Richard Anthony Dean's asked about the impact of the cathedral on the architecture of the Paris churches. Peter Harper asking whether the Italian church in Wilton is just too eccentric. There are many more, but we could talk for hours, no doubt.
And Mark, could I take sort of privilege and just answer the one from Elliot Turner, since it concerns me, is when can we hope for a full Surrey revision? Yeah. Just say I am working on it, and I have committed to getting it finished for the later part of this year.
That's great news. But look, on that positive, celebratory, optimistic note, I think that's a very good way to end. Huge thanks to you, Charles. Huge thanks to you, Julian, and to you, James, for a really wonderful presentation. And thanks for all of you for attending, all more than 200 of you. I hope you've enjoyed the event. And I really urge you to attend further events in our programme over the coming months. And we really look forward to seeing you all again. Thanks very much indeed. Bye now.